Hi everybody, I'm about to be joined by Deputy Clinical Director of CRGH, Fertility Clinic in London. And this evening we're going to talk all about PCOS. So we've already had many people sending questions, thank you for that. Feel free to ask, as Dr. Saab and I discussed, I can see that he's here now. So let me just add him. Hello to those who are joining, nice evening.
Hi there.
We have so much to talk about. It is such a brilliant topic to delve into, and we will answer all of your questions. So really looking forward to this. He should be here in a second. Let me invite again. So we're going to talk about nutrition for PCOS, symptoms for PCOS, managing PCOS, what that means for fertility. Hello, Dr. Saab.
Hello, Eloise. How are you?
I'm well, thank you.
Well, I'm just putting out my camera.
Just bring it down a little bit and then we can see you.
Better now?
Yeah, better now.
Perfect. How are you?
I'm well, thank you. I think it's been a long time since we spoke, perhaps in January of this year.
I believe so. You're right. How have you been?
Yes, well, thanks. I had COVID when we last spoke, so I'm...
Well, I remember that. Back to normal.
Yeah.
Good.
To everyone joining, I've just been introducing yourself as the Deputy Clinical Director at CRGH Fertility Clinic in London. And today we're going to be discussing everything around PCOS. So please introduce yourself a little bit more. And then I've got some questions to ask you that came in advance, if that's okay.
Of course. So I'm Dr. Saab. I'm one of the fertility doctors and the deputy clinical director at CRGH. I have been there for 15 years right now, and I'm also an associate professor at University College London as well. So my work and my passion is treating basically, people coming for fertility treatment. And I'm very pleased when I learned that we are going to discuss today polycystic ovaries. I hope that I'll be able to answer as many questions as possible. But this is the one topic that is very important, that we keep on being asked about it almost in every single meeting. There's one or two or three lectures about polycystic specifically, because it does cover a broad spectrum of fertility stuff, and also not fertility related stuff as well, as we will be discussing later on this evening.
Perfect. To those who are joining who may not know, could you explain what PCOS is and what it stands for, please?
Eloise, polycystic ovary syndrome, I have to say it's a little bit of a misnomer, because as the name says, it is a polycystic ovary. So there are lots of cysts in the ovaries. While in fact, what is present in the ovaries are not cysts. They are tiny bags of fluid that we refer to them as follicles. But ladies with polycystic ovaries, rather than having the average number, which is around 5 to 7 on every ovary, most of the time those ladies have plenty of follicles in the ovary. Yet the definition of polycystic ovaries have been changing across the years. So there was an NIH definition in the 90s. There's the Rotterdam classification in 2003. It has been changing. And polycystic ovary syndrome is known as two additional names. And personally, I like one of those names. It is referred to as hyperandrogenic anovulation, which, to be honest, this summarizes everything, which speaks that ladies or people who suffer from polycystic ovaries might have some form of increase in androgens or the male hormones, whether biochemically in a blood test or basically based on clinically. And anovulation, those people might suffer from ovulation problems as well. So they end up not ovulating on time, or even not ovulating at all in some cases.
Mm-hmm. And for these people who suffer from PCOS, they may or may not have had a diagnosis. Does that mean that they are infertile? Because I've had so many women and friends and readers, worry and assume that that diagnosis means it's going to be an issue having a child. Is that the case?
Very, very, very good question, Louise, because always you go to Dr. Google, you Google polycystic, and always polycystic equals infertility. Well, that's not true, I have to say. Definitely ladies who suffer from polycystic ovaries will be at a higher risk of having fertility issues, yet plenty of ladies have polycystic ovaries, they conceive without even knowing. Just to give you an idea that what people don't know is polycystic ovary syndrome or polycystic ovaries is the most common endocrine disorder in ladies at the reproductive age group. So it's not the thyroid, it's not the pituitary, it is the polycystic ovaries, which is the most common. And actually, although this is a bit of an old statistics, but the WHO, for example, in 2010, they mentioned that approximately there's a total of 3.2% or 3.4% of the world population, or from the ladies' population in the world, suffer from polycystic ovaries, which was at that point in time estimated to be 116 million.
Wow.
So that is, and again, the more lax is, because like anything in life, if you make the definition, you know, a little bit more lax, then more ladies will fall under this big umbrella of the polycystic ovaries. Going back to your question is that, yes, ladies with polycystic ovaries might suffer from fertility issues because they are not ovulating on time, but it's not a must. Some ladies might be completely fertile. They mainly report, if I'm taking a medical history from a person who suffers from polycystic ovaries, the typical history is that rather than having every 28 days a cycle, which is the textbook cycle, mm-hmm. those ladies will report, or those people report a cycle every 30 days or 31 days.
Okay.
So that is typically what happens with polycystic. In addition, for polycystic ovaries have other symptoms as well. I'm sure most probably we'll answer those later in our discussion.
Yeah, I want to ask you all about that. But first of all, can I ask you, who commonly suffers from PCOS?
Ladies who suffer from PCOS or people who suffer from PCOS mainly belong to the reproductive age group. And mainly it's present in ladies who are younger than 35. I'm saying mainly because that is not exclusively. So to simplify the matter, because we always, when we mention polycystic ovaries, we always mention that it's bad, it's about fertility, it's about this, but about that. It's always nice to put, I always describe that as a spectrum. So if I'm looking at the ovarian reserve as the spectrum, with the lowest ovarian reserve being menopause, polycystic ovaries is the other extreme. So in other words, those ladies are more or less, they are super fertile, yet they are not ovulating on time. And that's why they are having this fertility issues. So mainly it presents in ladies with a younger age bracket, mainly during their reproductive years.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the impact on fertility is obviously the lack of ovulation.
That's right.
Because when you said to me earlier, and this is something I've heard before, and I've always thought, wow, that sounds like a wonderful result. To have multiple follicles sounds like a good thing. But are those follicles that you retrieve from someone with PCOS, what's the air quality like? Does that have any effect?
Again, basically, when we say basically we have a good ovarian reserve, obviously we don't want to be misleading things. It is relatively good news. You are 100% right. It's not completely good news in the sense that most of the time, if we take eggs out from ladies having polycystic ovaries after ovarian stimulation for IVF, for instance, we do recognize sometimes that we will be end up having more eggs compared to a lady who does not have polycystic ovaries. Sometimes we have problems with the maturation of those eggs. So we have a higher tendency if we collect, for example, 15 eggs, a good percentage of those eggs to be immature, for instance. We collect more eggs, yet you are right, a good percentage of those eggs might be chromosomally not right, or they might have some issues. So while if we reach a day, there are other complications also from ladies having polycystic ovaries coming through fertility treatment. When we stimulate their ovaries with those hormones, it is very difficult to fine-tune the dose of medications. So we go from ovaries not responding at all to ovaries overreacting to those drugs. Mm-hmm. And that's why any discussion with a lady with polycystic ovaries undergoing IVF treatment, the discussion would start with the risks of ovarian hyperstimulation, for example, to be the first risk for those ladies having fertility treatment.
And before we talk about options for treating PCOS and fertility, is it something that runs in the family? Is it hereditary?
That's true. Polycystic ovary is a combination of both. There's environmental factors and there are genetic factors. And there's a reason why I'm mentioning both. The environmental factors, it has been shown that people who get exposed in utero to what is referred to these days as endocrine disruptors, like bisphenol, for example, those ladies or those women, they will be at a high risk of developing polycystic ovaries as in their adult life. We cannot rule out genetic factors because, again, studies from identical twins show that if one of the twins suffer from polycystic, there's a very high possibility that the other twin will be suffering compared to fraternal twins. Other things, for instance, is that it is thought that polycystic ovaries is inherited in an autosomal dominant way. There's no gene that at the moment is specifically isolated for polycystic, because otherwise we'll ask everyone, go and test yourself for this gene. You have polycystic or you don't have polycystic, which is not the case. And it is important to know that it is inherited from both sides of the family. And this is a myth buster for some ladies who believe that, oh, I've got it only from my mother's side. No, it might still be from your father's side. And it's very weird that even those genetic factors are also transmitted to also men or males, but in men it's not going to be recognized. Those men will typically refer later in life that they have early loss of hair, early baldness, excessive hair growth in the body, but in men it is dismissed, while those are a little bit more obviously will present as polycystic ovaries in ladies. So it has a genetic component and it has an environmental component as well.
So, symptoms of PCOS for women. Excess hair growth, is that right?
That's right.
And weight gain or issues controlling weight, is that
But
true as well?
to simplify the matter, I always, when I give, when I speak to my, our medical students, sometimes I mention that if we divide things to hyperandrogenism, which is increase in the male hormone, and the other thing is insulin resistance, then everything that I'm going to mention right now will make so much sense. For the hyperandrogenic, obviously increase in the malish hormone, so ladies or people will complain of oily skin, acne, bitemporal baldness or decrease in scalp hair, increase in body hair and thickening of the hair. Hyperandrogenism will also present itself like irregularity in the period, as we mentioned. So those people will have periods are a little bit on the long side. And the other part, which is the insulin resistance, means the cells are resistant to insulin, which causes mainly is associated with obesity. So typically, around 80% of ladies with polycystic ovaries suffer from obesity, but not exclusively, because 20% are what we refer to as ladies, lean ladies with polycystic ovaries. And that issue with is associated with obesity. Insulin resistance is associated with hyperpigmentation in the skin. And that's why there might be patches in the skin that look a little bit darker. We also have issues with fertility because of the ovulation. And there are some complications a little bit on the long term. For fertility, for example, there might be a little slighter, higher risk of miscarriage. And when it comes on the long-term complications, possibly they are interrelated with obesity and the insulin resistance. People with polycystic ovaries might be at a high risk of developing gestational diabetes or high sugar during pregnancy, type 2 diabetes later in life. We also they are associated with sleep apnea. And in ladies who don't have a period or have very irregular periods, it might be associated with something called endometrial hyperplasia or thickening of the lining. And very rarely, I don't want to scare, very rarely it might be associated with cancer of the lining or endometrial cancer. But that will be very rarely, as I mentioned.
And so, for treatment options, you've got Western medicine, you've also got I'm sure people have all sorts of different
types
of treatment, and also people look at diet and nutrition. First of all, do you think that holistic care supports that? So do you think that you can help PCOS with what you're eating or not eating to begin with?
That's 100%. Like anything in medicine, it is impossible to say there's one pill that you take that will be the cure for everything. I hope it's the case, but unfortunately, it's not the case. And always basically, whether the classical Western medical approach, which we'll be discussing in a second, or the holistic approach, which is always complementary to the treatment, is very important. Yeah. You should always target different aspects of the illness. The easiest is weight loss. The easiest, I'm saying the easiest, but I understand that patients or people who suffer from polycystic might not agree with me, because as we mentioned, there's a problem with metabolism. And typically, those ladies are trying all forms of exercise, diets, and they always mention we struggle to lose weight. So we start from the simplest treatment, or simplest in the means it's not medical treatment, which is weight loss. And weight loss, mainly it's by limiting carbs intake. I advise, for example, my patients to try to, with polycystic, to avoid having carbs after 6 p.m. at night. And mainly is that when we consume carbs early during the day, we have time to burn the carbs. Simple carbs after in the evening, we don't have enough time to burn them, so they end up being accumulated in subcutaneous fat and in visceral fat. Other thing which is quite important also on the diet, actually there's some evidence, not very strong, but some supplements like myo-inositol, which you can get over the counter from lots of the food supplement shops that are present on the high street. You don't need a prescription for that. This has been shown to improve ovulation, for example, and improve insulin resistance. So myo-inositol is used in those people. Other, which is very important, is ladies with polycystic ovaries are at a high risk of having vitamin D deficiency. So vitamin D, myo-inositol, simple things that you can get over the counter, might assist ladies in ovulating. Still, before we shift gears to discuss the classical medical approach, other things are alternative therapy like acupuncture, other forms of holistic therapy. I don't have the right to say they don't work, because that's not true, but I can say there's insufficient evidence, or insufficient strong evidence, to support that they, when used on their own, they will help. Mm-hmm. So that's why, as a complementary or as an adjuvant therapy, it's fine, but I don't think exclusively that will be the best way forward.
So what about Western medicine? How would you treat a patient who may have PCOS? What would you do at CRGH to help someone with PCOS?
So we would start with insulin, going back, insulin resistance. And before I go on that, so I will limit my answer. So what we do at CRGH, and I'll tell you why I'm mentioning I'm not going to limit my answer there, because what I'm mentioning right now is the treatment of polycystic ovaries in ladies seeking fertility, or in people seeking fertility treatment. We should not ignore completely there's a big percentage of ladies who suffer from polycystic who are not even interested at the moment fertility treatment.
Yeah.
But for fertility treatment, we always start by insulin sensitizers like metformin that will help in sensitizing those cells to insulin, causing weight loss, helping in weight loss, improving ovulation. That's number one. Other things when it comes to a treatment might be tablets to improve ovulation, like clomiphene citrate, letrozole. A step higher will be injections to induce ovulation, which is going through IVF treatment. So in severe cases, which is rarely used those days, is surgery or operations to polycystic ovaries.
But should someone assume that if they have a diagnosis of PCOS, they're going to have IVF?
No, that's not true. That's definitely not the case. We remember that in any treatment, you go from the simplest treatment and you step up the algorithm step by step. The first is to make sure whether those ladies or those people are ovulating. Mm-hmm. Because if they are ovulating and they don't know when they are ovulating, something as easy as asking them to have timed intercourse or timed insemination and giving them some progesterone afterwards might do the job. If that is not the case and they are not ovulating at all, we go to the tablets or the injections where we are helping them ovulate. and do insemination. If that fails, then we go to the third treatment, which is IVF.
Okay, so IUI comes before IVF in this instance.
That's
That's what
correct. And
you mean in clinic.
that's 100% true. Yet, Louise, we have to factor in other variables. To be honest, if we have a lady coming with polycystic ovaries at the age of 41, closer to 42, I might be a little bit reluctant of using insemination to start with,
Yeah.
because every single month count, and we know that insemination success rate is lower than IVF. So I might go directly to IVF in that case.
You mentioned women who are overweight and losing weight. What about women who are underweight and need to put on weight?
Polycystic ovaries in lean ladies, it is thought that it is associated with a component of hypogonadotropic hypogonadism. And what that means is that it is thought that those ladies might have an issue with the brain ordering the ovaries to stimulate the ovaries. And in that subcategory of ladies, obviously, weight gain. So, too thin in general is not good for fertility. A bit on the heavy side or very high BMI is not good for fertility. So always in BMI within the reference, within what is referred to as the norm, is the best way forward.
And how can women who are taking things like Clomid and the other drugs that you've mentioned to try and get ovulation to occur, what are the side effects of those? How can you manage your life whilst you're on this medication?
You don't have anything. So let's start, for example, with Clomid. Clomid is one of the oldest fertility drugs in the market. So if any one of us said, basically heard his nan or her nan saying, "I had fertility treatment back then," it's most probably Clomid. Clomid are pills that work on the brain. They will fake the brain, saying that there's a state of menopause, there's a drop in estrogen. So the brain will start ordering those ovaries to by producing more FSH to stimulate the ovaries. Why I started with that discussion? Because that will give us the side effects. Since those pills work on the brain to tell the brain there's a drop of estrogen, so it makes sense that those pills might give some menopausal symptoms because the brain understands there's no estrogen. Since those pills act on the brain, some ladies might suffer from migraine. Since the eyes are the extension of the brain, some ladies will say that they're having some spots or bright spots of light that I can see. This is the side effect. Since those pills act to fake that there's a low estrogen, they might thin out the lining. And obviously, when we stimulate the ovary, we are always asking the body to produce more than one egg, or sometimes the body produces more than one egg, so there's the risk of multiple pregnancy. With injections to stimulate the ovary, they are a little bit more aggressive, a little bit more medically intrusive. So the risk of hyperstimulation or where the ovary overreacts to the drugs, this will be a little bit more than pills like Clomid, for instance.
Okay, that's interesting. Thank you so much for explaining that. I'm just trying to think what else we were going to discuss. Has anyone got any questions for Dr. Saab whilst we're live? I see if we've got any further up.
While you're doing that, Louise, it's for example, regarding the weight loss, it's a very common question patients ask, how much do I need to lose weight? Is it 2 stones, 3 stones, 1 stones? Is there a target BMI? Obviously, it makes sense that the closer you get your BMI to the normal, the better. Yet, there are some recommendations. For example, there's a recommendation from the American Society of Reproductive, of Clinical Endocrinologists. They say to improve insulin resistance in ladies with polycystic ovaries who has a high BMI, they need to lose approximately 55 to 15% of their body weight for insulin resistance to improve.
Wow, that's a lot, isn't it?
That's a lot. That's a lot. That's a lot.
It's a huge pressure on someone on top of the struggle as it is.
100%. And that's why, to be honest, sometimes it's a little bit difficult sitting there giving patients, lose weight, while we know that those poor people are trying their best to lose weight. And if they have poor metabolism, whatever they do. And some people go to the extreme, which I'm personally against, I have to say, which is they go on those. I'm not a big fan of starving diets, I have to say, like 600 calories 2 days a week and normal
Intermittent
diet.
fasting.
Intermittent fasting. I'm not a big fan of those because I have to say, evolution-wise, we are not meant to sit for days and days and days on limited number of calories. I have to say, it's just limit the number of calories, but have a well-balanced diet throughout rather than have intermittent fasting that can be quite harsh on the body.
And also, because I've tried that before, it can be quite difficult with concentration and mood regulation and things like that, because you get hangry.
100%. And actually, in polycystic ovaries, if you check what are the among the side effects or one of the symptoms, although we keep on unfortunately dismissing that because we consider other things to be more important. As I said, we consider because that's not the case. It has been shown that ladies with polycystic might be at a higher risk of having depression and anxiety.
Really?
And that's why mental health needs to be looked upon in that subcategory of patients, because it's not only about treating those ladies to have regular periods. Yeah. It's not only about treating those people to have fertility or treating them to have a period, but it's a little bit more than that. Mm-hmm. And sometimes we might think that polycystic ovary and fertility might be the tip of the iceberg. We see those people clinically coming for fertility treatment, yet there are other factors that are behind those that we need to tackle as well and treat.
Absolutely. Someone's just said it's the best advice they've ever heard from a clinic. So thank you so much. And a question is, myo-inositol,
is that how you say it? That's right. It's myo-inositol, which is, most of the studies have been on myo-inositol. Remember that basically some people take inositol, which is fine. There are some emerging study about a supplement called coenzyme Q10 as well.
And for air quality as well.
Exactly. From my personal experience, I didn't find a huge difference with that, I have to admit. Yet, I cannot deny what some studies that say it helps. So in general, I use it in addition to myo-inositol as an adjuvant to the regular treatment.
And what's the difference between them and why are they good for PCOS?
It is thought that myo-inositol might improve insulin. It all works about what we mentioned, the hyperandrogenism and the insulin resistance. It is thought that by one way or another, it improves insulin sensitivity.
Okay.
And hence it improves everything around that. One more thing, we don't routinely do that. Ladies with polycystic ovaries have, I don't want to sound very boring from detailed medical stuff, but they have a high level of a compound called homocysteine. Homocysteine is a substance that is associated with blood clotting. It's a natural substance. Some people, for example, have tried to use high levels of vitamin B to treat that. Again, I cannot say, yes, it's right, no, it's wrong, but these are things that you might come across when you are Googling things or when you are looking for nutritional support or nutritional treatment for polycystic ovaries.
Mm-hmm. Someone asked about treatment options, so I hope that we've covered everything. I feel like you've been very knowledgeable and you've given us a step-by-step guide of what people might consider. They might ask their doctor how you can help, how CRGH can help. Which I was going to ask you, I know that you offer mini consultations, don't you, for people who want find out what might be the best treatment path to have with yourself. So how can people find out more?
That's right. At CRGH, we offer free mini consultations, whether with myself or with any of our colleagues at CRGH. This will give the chance for any person to have a personalized discussion, to know this is my history, what kind of treatment will be offered to me at CRGH, what are the chances of success, and what are alternative treatments. Because it's very important for any person seeking fertility treatment, whether with us or anywhere else, is research, mm-hmm. research. That will give you enough information to reflect on, another information to go and do your own search, and then you will take a, because fertility journey is a roller coaster, unfortunately it is. And it's very important to make sure that you are, you know, dotting every I, crossing every T when it comes to your knowledge about the topic. So we offer these mini consultations. You will get a personalized or more or less what to expect from the treatment at CRGH. And obviously that will not oblige you by any means or standards to have treatment at CRGH. It's your personal choice. But at least you know what kind of treatment will be offered to you at CRGH.
Totally. And if people want to see someone very quickly, then of course they can book in for consultation too.
That's right. So faster things will be booking for consultation. We are quite a busy clinic, yet we are quite few clinicians right now. And we always try to accommodate as many new consultations in a shorter time frame possible, and we try to accommodate also for treatment because we offer a 7 day a week service. So we offer a collections, treatments, transfers over weekend, bank holidays. Obviously, apart from now, the December is quite tricky around Christmas and New Year, but things will go completely to normal from January, covering Easter, covering any form of bank holidays throughout the year.
And I don't know if you know, I know you're based in London, in the clinic in London, but I had the pleasure of going to meet your colleagues at your Canterbury clinic, which is
That's true.
beautiful in the
Dr.
heart of
Bumeno is.
Canterbury, Kent. And she gave me a scan to see how my fertility is right now at 36. So that was lovely to meet the team and have a
I'm
check
glad,
after.
I'm glad. I have to say, basically, not because I'm working, I might be a bit of subjective there, but at CRGH, we are lucky to be working the clinicians and the staff, nurses, embryologists, receptionists. We work as a close family more than, as colleagues and as a close family. We are quite close. I have to say, we are lucky to be working in a clinic with such an environment.
Absolutely, yeah, completely. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Saab. I hope we've answered everyone's questions. If
Many
you have
thanks,
any
Aline.
follow-up questions, please don't hesitate to get in touch with CRGH to book a consultation, and they'd be delighted to help you. And it's a really important conversation that we've had today. So, thank you for your time and your expertise
Many
as always.
thanks again. It's always a pleasure, Louise. And thanks for everyone who listened to us this evening.
Okay. Thank you, everyone, for joining.
Take
Bye
care.
bye.
Bye bye.
Bye.
Bye bye. Bye bye.